white people, but we are not equal. Thought the movie was over, but check it, here's the sequel. Don't take this as disrespect, I'm just building up my people. Started from the bottom, now we here, guess we beneath you. Not, but that's what...
I'm asked Detroit's native son, Yousef Bunchy Shakur, to come up here and do the intro. Woo! What up, though? What up, though, man?
Wow.
That's how we do it in Detroit. It's an honor and pleasure to be back here in Rochester. I've been here a few times. Some of you all who may not heard me speak or know anything about me, I am a community organizer with Restoring the Neighbor Back to the Hood. I'm an author of The Window to My Soul, Redemptive Soul, and My Soul Is Back, as well as produced the film Detroit Native Son. As we introduce Dhoruba Shakur, let me give you a little background. Had the great pleasure and honor in going to Ferguson with Ricardo and another brother named Z. And going there, we had the honor of meeting Dhoruba. At that time, we met his name with Jeffrey Hill. And it was a lot of young folks, young adults who were involved, who was making it happen. And they was organizing, and we had the opportunity to connect and really just get to know each other. You know, for myself, going to Ferguson, it wasn't going there trying to lead anything, wasn't going there trying to do any of those things, but it was going there to learn and listen. And so anytime that we want to address a problem, it's important that we listen to the people who are at the forefront of the problem, to which puts us in a position, if we have anything to offer, to make to where it becomes welcoming. And with us having that process, we was able to build a genuine relationship with Dhoruba over the course of his life, and our lives have began to change. He adopted us, we adopted him, and the mannerism of how we operate and organize began to impact each other, because the reality, if you guys haven't realized, Ferguson is not just that small little area. It is Rochester, New York. It is Detroit, Michigan. It is Harlem, New York. The challenging of challenging white supremacy doesn't just exist in Ferguson. The murder of Michael Brown just doesn't exist in Ferguson. So to understand the complexity of the problems, we have to understand the complexity of our own lives, of how we are part of the problem. How we are part of the problem. And when you look at the young folks and what they're doing in Ferguson, they're saying no longer will I be part of the problem, but I will step up and be part of the solution. See, when you sit on the sideline, ain't doing a goddamn thing, you're part of the problem. When you're sitting in your home, you're just talking and not doing nothing, you're part of the problem. And when we're saying doing something, it's just that, doing something. It may be on the front line, it may be writing, it may be donating, it may be a lot of different things. And there's a lot of different things that we can do to support. There's a lot of things that we can do to support. So understanding the complexity of the problems is by looking at the problem head on. And that's what the young people in Ferguson are doing. They're looking at the problem head on. So we had the opportunity to go back to Missouri part of the weekend of resistance. And it was such a beautiful experience to see Dhoruba from the first time we met him, had the opportunity to bring him to Detroit. I mean, I remember vividly when I first was there with him, and he was trying to organize and talk. He's like, come here, man, you talk for me. You go convince this guy. And to see him now, talking with such confidence. And so sometimes many of us, our confidence get beat up by the people around us. Like many of us doesn't choose to be in a position that we're in, but because of the work that we do, puts us in the position that we're in. So, and we understand it's not about an individual, it's about a collective. And the individual represents the collective. It's like, again, if everybody in this room was talking, we wouldn't hear a goddamn thing. So we need everybody to be quiet in the sense of not for me to dominate, just to listen. And then we can engage in conversation. And the point I'm making is, like, even though we may say individual represents multitude of people. The reality, we don't have money to bring the whole tribe X, right? We don't have the whole money to bring the freedom fighters, et cetera, but Dhoruba is an extension of that group, of those groups. I'm an extension of other folks. And that's how we have to organize and operate in that fashion. But we have to have the core values. We have to have the core values that is significant, that demands of us to have a people orientation. So it gives me great honor and pleasure to bring my brother and my comrade, who exemplifies that collective mentality, that collective work. But he is an individual that is struggling and with his own complexity for the greater good. So hopefully when we leave tonight, that we'll all look at ourselves and say that we want not just here to just listen, but to be activated to do some shit. Dhoruba Shakur.
What up, y'all? What up? Is it cool if I sit down?
Yeah.
I want to get kind of comfortable. It's kind of a scary position. I'm gonna bring my girlfriend up here. This is Sixela Yoccm. She's been holding me down. She can introduce me. Yeah. So I'm there isn't really a structure to this event. I was told it's just let loose. So I'm gonna do that for y'all. I'm gonna start with the beginning. Previous to August 9th, which was a Saturday, I wasn't involved in any organizations. I participated in a few events where I'm from in Kansas City, Missouri, and when I moved to St. Louis, I participated in a few events that were based around social injustice, just on my own. And Mike Brown's death, just for lack of better words, just activated me on a level that I had never been activated before, to where I felt like this was at the forefront of my life. You know what I'm saying? I had to put everything that I had to offer into it. So that's what I did. If you guys aren't familiar with the story of Mike Brown, he was leaving a store and walking back to his home, the Canfield Apartments, which is in Ferguson, Missouri, which is a suburb. Maybe it's supposed to be a suburb. It's not really a suburb anymore, but it's about 5-10 minutes away from St. Louis, Missouri. And when he got to his neighborhood, he was approached by an officer by the name of Darren Wilson, and can I be raw here, y'all?
Yeah,
raw. He told him to get the fuck out of the street, him and his friend. They refused to get out of the street because they're walking to the apartment complex. It's something that they do all the time. People walk across the street. He then tried to hit them with the car, with the SUV that he was driving. Then the first person, which was Mike Brown's friend, he ran past the car. Mike Brown then tried to follow. Darren Wilson reached out of the car, grabbed Mike Brown. There was a scuffle. When Mike Brown got away, the cop fired 2 shots at him, both of them hitting Mike Brown. Mike Brown didn't want to be shot anymore, so he put his hands up, said, "Don't shoot," and was on his knees when the officer approached him and fired off several more rounds, which led to his death. On top of that, they blocked the scene off with the yellow tape. The entire neighborhood is out there because the place where his body was is like an apartment complex, which it's in Ferguson, but that complex was kind of like a community of its own. If you've ever lived in an apartment complex, it's similar to that. It's about 12 different units. Each unit maybe has 20 to 35 doors in it, and he was murdered right in the central location of all of that, in the middle of the street. And he was left out for 4.5 hours, uncovered the entire time. So even if you saw what had happened on social media, you were able to take a shower, pick up a couple of your friends, and go down to the crime scene, and you would still see his body exposed. One of the bullets, which had entered in the top of his head. So just imagine seeing a dead body with blood everywhere, even coming out of his head. Little kids, his family's there. And like I said, you could have showed up 2 hours later and you still would have seen the same scene. And it kind of traumatized, it did traumatize everyone in the complex and anyone that saw that. I didn't make it to the crime scene that Saturday, August 9th. But me and my friends, we went out there August the 10th, which was a Sunday, and we get to the apartment complex, and there's clergy there, and they're having these like prayer circles, and you can tell that something very traumatic had just happened there. And when I get to the scene, I'm just trying to figure out what had happened. Actually, let me go back before I explain this. A few more incidents that weren't in the news that you guys might not have heard about. After he was murdered and left out for 4.5 hours, the police attempted to put his body in the trunk of a police car. Not a police SUV, but a police car. And the entire community was inflamed by this, so the police had to maneuver a little differently, and they eventually ended up taking his body in a police SUV, which still isn't normal protocol. If you're alive, they're gonna rush you off in an ambulance, and if you're deceased at the scene, they're gonna take you away in a black coroner's van. Neither one of those were done. He was escorted in a police SUV, which there are photos of. You can see that. And that was how that Saturday ended. Sunday, like I said, thousands of people were out at this time to show their respects for Mike Brown and his family, to show their condolences. And after about 30 minutes to an hour of just prayer, people were kind of agitated, and they wanted to act, they wanted to be vocal with how they were feeling. So one man had yelled out, "Hey, let's go to West Florida." And me and my group of friends, we were like, "Yeah, let's do that." You know what I mean? Like, it's a lot of people out here. We could easily block off this street. West Florida is one of the main roads in Ferguson. So we start to tell everybody to go out to West Florida. So we're yelling this out. And eventually we get a good number to come with us, which later follows that the entire crowd comes out to West Florida. So we're blocking West Florida, and the clergy are kind of pissed off that we kind of ruined their prayer that they had going on, but they eventually get to the front of the crowd with their bullhorns, and they kind of direct us in chants and stuff like that, which was cool. So we're out there, no justice, no peace, and we're blocked off the main road, and then the police are flying down, and they've created kind of like a line, which I'm sure you guys have seen before, when the police show up to something that they have to react to. They don't just react when they're on the scene. They gather up in an area and they all get together, and they have a strategy that they do. And so they all got on one end of West Florida, and they create this blockade, and we're marching towards them. No justice, no peace, and everything's peaceful. And this anarchist kid, he's there with a group of people, but he was by himself at the moment. He had an amplifier with a radio on it. And he was playing this song, which was like the theme song for the whole day that people were playing in their cars. And it's a song by Lil Boosie called "Fuck the Police." So he cranks this up in the middle of "No Justice, No Peace." And the entire mood of everyone out there changed to "Fuck the Police." And so there were more cop cars that were coming to get through the line, and they had to go through the crowd of protesters. And since everybody's mood had changed to "Fuck the Police," they acted on that by kicking cars and throwing bricks through windows as they drove by and spitting on people and stuff like that, because they were pissed off at the events that they had just saw. And Sunday is, out of 2,000 people, that's the one day that I could say 1,200-1,300 people were going into stores eventually, you know what I'm saying, because people were so pissed off. And the entire time that people were doing this, which lasted maybe 3 to 4 hours, the police held their line. They didn't engage in anyone breaking in the stores, and they pretty much just watched it until it died down in that area. There were a few break-ins in the surrounding areas that had nothing really to do with the protest. People kind of saw that as an opportunity, since the police were occupied, to break into other stores, and they did. And a few of those people outside of West Florissant were arrested, and there's footage of that that they show. That following Monday, they had a rally in Clayton, Missouri, which is where the prosecutor Bob McCullough, his office is at. So people who are organizations that had been created before Mike Brown, they took this as an opportunity to kind of change the focus in what areas they saw fit. They saw the energy that was there the previous night, and they're like, let's try to push this to the places that we see fit. So we heard there was a rally going on there. We went there. I happened to meet this man by the name of Montega, who is like the chairman of OBS, which is Organization for Black Struggle. They've been around for about 30, 31 years in St. Louis. And when I saw him there, he invited me to a meeting. And he said that he felt my energy from the day before, and that I had influence and whatnot, and he wanted to invite me to this meeting. So we participated in that rally. And I go to that meeting, and that was the first meeting of multiple organizations that came together, unions, to form what was called the Don't Shoot Coalition. And it's the first meeting for that. So that was my introduction into this whole organizing arena. And it was pretty chill, you know what I'm saying? I feel like we were all kind of on the same page. There were other organizations that were based around like housing and environmental things, but they saw this as an opportunity, I guess, to heighten the things that were going on and to also pull in people and to show that kind of the things that we were going through, there's a much more broad thing going on here. So I felt like that was something that I should be a part of. So I did that. Later on that night, we go out to Ferguson again, and it's a couple thousand people out there, but the looting, it was a drastic difference in the looting. And that was the last day of the looting. Out of 2,000 people that were there, maybe 200, 300 people were trying to loot. The store owners had started to protect their businesses a lot better. And there were actually protesters who were out there, like Bloods and Crips, Vice Lords, GDs, gangs who would usually kill each other in any other situation. They were coming together and they were protecting stores. So just to make one thing clear, I don't know if you guys watch any of the mainstream media, they kind of portrayed us to be looting for about 2 weeks straight, 2.5. That was an absolute lie. It was only 2 days, and they just kept showing the same footage from those 2 days over and over again. So we're doing that. Eventually, after coming out night after night, the police saw that their tactics weren't efficient, which eventually led to them using tear gas and rubber bullets and noise grenades and flashbangs. We saw drones. They were flying in the air. They weren't shooting anything out of the drones, but the drones were kind of doing like a surveillance and going in a circle around the Ferguson area. The police had made Ferguson a no-fly zone for any aircraft that was lower than 3,000 feet, which would be like news helicopters and stuff like that. They weren't allowed to fly for 2 weeks, and they quarantined the city for 2 weeks, I would say, a little bit less than 2 weeks. And it's just a horrible situation that we were going through in Ferguson. And it gained the national attention. Media started to come out because the Quick Trip was set on fire. Oh, I skipped that part completely. On that Sunday, which was the second day, that same anarchist kid who changed the whole mood, he was actually the first person to throw a brick through the Quick Trip window that day. And as you know, once he threw that brick through the window, everybody else just followed, and eventually that Quick Trip burned down. I disagreed with their tactics at first. Whatever day today is, October 22nd, I want to say I 100% agree with their tactics at this point. sorry about that. This is me being raw. This is not a representation of Tribex right now, but that's me personally. I agree with those tactics today. But we go through these traumatizing events for 2 weeks. To make a long story short, these organizations that we had become a part of were promising us things, that the youth would be at the forefront of these issues and that the resources that were available to them would be available to us. We soon found out that that wasn't the case. We eventually quit working for those organizations because a lot of us were under a stipend program. If you guys are not aware of that, it's a temporary job, I guess, for lack of better words, doing organizing. And so we lasted about a month before we realized what was going on, and we quit, and we formed a group called Freedom Fighters, which was a group of individuals who were part of Hands Up and Don't Shoot. And we were all 25 and below, and we quit and decided to do our own thing. Before I go any further, I want to point out the things that I had saw during the really intense part of the Ferguson situation, which is like the tear gas and stuff. The organizations were able to use their resources to create a safe space, which was a Greater St. Mark's Church, because when you were on West Florissant, the tear gas, they would start to shoot that out, which would push people further back. Like, people would stay out there as long as they could until the tear gas became overwhelming, and it would keep pushing you back, and you weren't allowed to go past them, you know what I'm saying? So if your car was parked down here and they pushed you back so far, you weren't able to get back to your vehicle till the next morning, 5 or 6 o'clock in the morning, when they decided to stop patrolling you. So the safe space was created by them for people to be able to go to and get food and get gas masks, water, and Maalox and things like that. So I appreciate them using their resources in that matter, in that manner. But at the end of the day, I later found out that if these social issues didn't exist, there would be no need for these organizations. So at the end of the day, they weren't about systemic change. They were just about highlighting these things so that they could generate funds, in my eyes, which is what a lot of them did. And this whole thing started with the black community saying enough is enough. And the organizations that came in, they were trying to broaden the spectrum, because they all are stems from the same tree, and they're connected. But when they did that, they kind of undermined the thing that started it in the first place. So one thing I want to say is, I understand that, like, gay issues and Palestinian issues and South American issues, all these different issues, they're connected, but the black community kind of brought this stuff to the forefront, to where it was a conversation. So I feel like those organizations that are, these other issues may be their focus. Whenever something like this happens, I feel like organizations should attack that head on and keep that narrative, because it's what started it. And once we can come to an ending point on fixing those things, then we can then move on to these other areas. And that didn't happen. And after we quit, the major organizations, since they have the resources and they have the ability to stretch out, they put on what was called Resistance Weekend, which just passed this weekend, and it was supposed to be a weekend of resistance. And if anybody here was there, the first 2 days of that, it was a huge party. It was like a celebration for everybody, and it's like we haven't won anything. So at this point, Tribe X had been created, which was another group of individuals who had been out with us since day one, and I joined Tribe X. And our job was to kind of take back the narrative of what they were doing. So we didn't agree with their methods, but they did mobilize thousands of people in 1 weekend. So we kind of wanted to use that to our advantage. It was Friday. Friday they went out to Clayton again, and it was a police escorted rally, which isn't the point. Saturday they had the same type of event. And at that point, we just had enough. So we decided to do an action at the Cardinals game. If you've ever been to St. Louis, Cardinals is life. Like, nothing else matters but Cardinals. So we saw that as an opportunity to really disrupt. And we went there and we did a rally. We protested. We created a memorial for Mike Brown and Von Derrick Myers there. And we were able to kind of show with the media presence that we had there what St. Louis was really about, the people who are not out there. And people, like, some people seem to think that this problem that we're facing is a small group of people who are enforcing these things. But we realize that it's a large group of people. And even though those people may not be vocal, we can agitate them in the right areas to where that will come out. So that's what the Cardinals action was about. We did that. And then later on that day, we put our social media presence together, and we were able to mobilize about 300 people to the Ground Zero site of Von Derrick Myers, which is the third person who was killed by the police in the past 2 months. And after doing that, we realized how much power we really had as individuals, and that we didn't need the big organizations to do the things that we were doing. And we can really take back the narrative. So we did an action that day, which it was the first time for a lot of people who had came in for Resistance Weekend to experience resistance for real. as soon as we hit Grand Avenue, the tactical tank was there with the tear gas. There was hundreds of officers in riot gear, and people were radicalized. We ended up going to Grand in Arsenal, which is a major business district in South City, St. Louis, and people were arrested, and like I said, it was their first taste of what St. Louis has been going through for the past 2 months. So the following day, they had kind of a panel discussion with Cornel West and some people who had flew in town. And no, I'm skipping ahead. After the first night in Ferguson, or in South City, we did it again in South City. And this time, we, at the organizers who were with us, we organized a action to go to Quick Trip, because that was one of the things that burned down at the very beginning of all this. So we wanted to show that the youth has progressed. We don't need to burn things down to get our point across. We can show how brutal you guys really are by not destroying anything. So we marched down the sidewalks. We chanted, we tried to abide by the rules as much as possible so that we could get to the place that we were trying to get. The organizations that came together to plan that, we strategized, and we decided that the best way to get this done is to mobilize the people and then to just pretty much let them know, hey, we're gonna participate in civil disobedience. There's a chance that you can go to jail. If you want to go, just come. Instead of like telling people what we're going to do ahead of time, putting it on social media and like screwing up the whole thing, we just let them know, hey, this is the deal. If you want to follow us, you can follow us. So a lot of people did. We ended up going to Quick Trip, and we sat in front of the Quick Trip because Quick Trip, they found out that we were coming last minute because the police were trailing us the entire way because they didn't know what was going on. So they just rode on the side of us until we decided to stop. And once we stopped in Quick Trip, we sat down with our faces facing the building and our backs to the police. And to make a long story short, the police, they started to hit people with their batons and their riot shields. And I think it was 19 people that got arrested, and that radicalized a lot of people who were out there with us. They then knew what we were facing in St. Louis, and there was a big difference in the actions that we were planning and the actions that the major wars were planning. So the following day, that's when Cornel West had his event at Chaffetz Arena, and people were disappointed by what they went to go see. It was that Sunday, which is the third day of the weekend. There was a lot of clergy there, and I'm sorry, I'm being raw again. The youth, my generation, we're not really for praying to get our answers. You know what I'm saying? We're about getting on the ground and really acting. So that whole meeting was pretty much about praying and working within legislation and things like that. People were disgusted after going through the events that they had went through the night before with us. So me and my friends, we went to Chaffetz, and we got on bullhorns, and we were like, everybody, if you want to experience the real weekend of resistance, come to Shaw and Clem, which was ground zero. And we ended up mobilizing thousands of people. It was like amazing, you know what I'm saying? It was crazy. So we get down there, and once again, we've been dealing with this for 2 months, so we kind of caught on to the police tactics, and we decided that we should split the groups in half, send one group out. They were, the name of that group was, they think it's a game, they think it's a joke, because that's one of the chants. They think it's a game, they think it's a joke, they think it's a game, they think it's a joke. So they go out, and it takes them about 30 minutes to get to their spot, and they block off the entire street, they pull out board games, they're jump roping, they're doing all kinds of crazy shit in the streets. And us that waited there at the spot, we saw all the police just like zooming by, like they were once blocking off this main road that they thought we were going to go to, and they're zooming to this other place because they're getting all these calls about this crazy shit going on in the streets. And so that's when it was our opportunity to start marching, and we go on the sidewalk, and our group is completely silent, and we're marching on the sidewalk, and we had Von Derek Meyer's parents and his family there, which was unexpected. That wasn't planned. They just happened to be there, like a gift from God, that they were there and they wanted to participate in these events with us. So they led our group, and we go down, and we finally get to that main road, which the police were blocking. And keep in mind, we're on the sidewalk and completely silent the entire time that we make this journey. It's about a mile and a half, 2 mile walk. We get to the other side of the Grand Bridge and we're met by police on the sidewalk, and they try to block us, and they're beating their stuff on the ground to try to intimidate us. The mother and father of Von Derrick Myers are in the front of this. The mother's crying. The same people that are beating their sticks and doing this stuff in front of us are the same people that just murdered their son 4 days before this. So it was like a real emotional time. We didn't know what the hell to do, you know what I'm saying? Some of the leaders were having arguments out there because we're like, we should do this, we should do that. And after like 15 minutes, 30 minutes of that, eventually the police just move out of the way because they get a call from the other team on the other side that our other group is now walking up and meeting us on the bridge. So they're like intimidated, like, what's going on? So they move, and then all of a sudden we all meet, and it's this epic ass thing. And we're like celebrating, and we're like, hold on, we didn't get there yet. So we march and we get to SLU's campus, and we pretty much take over SLU's campus with thousands of people. And we burst their bubble that they thought existed, and the symbolism in that was we were bringing our issues to their face. Like, no longer can you guys just turn off your TV and ignore the issues that we deal with on a day-to-day. You're gonna have to see it head on. And so a lot of us decided to occupy SLU, and we stayed there for 6 days. We got parents calling in, talking about Tribex and freedom fighters are gonna rape their daughters. We got guns, we're armed and dangerous. Like, they're really intimidated by our presence. And the president of SLU, weirdly enough, which we didn't know, had co-signed the event before that, Cornell West, because it was held in one of their facilities. So he's like all for fighting against social injustice. And for him to kick us off the campus would be to eat his own words. So he had to maneuver a little bit differently. And so we came up with a list of demands, and it was like a crazy list. Like, one of the demands being like, they have to either build us or buy us a building so that we can service the community, because we believe that servicing our community is the real way for liberation. And they give us everything. They give us everything off the list. And it was crazy. I'm sure I missed a whole lot of shit in between that whole gap, because I just went through like 2 months. And yeah, it's some crazy shit. If you want to add anything to that.
Hi. First of all, I want to thank Ricardo and Rochester for having us here. Really appreciate the opportunity. My experiences in Ferguson happened a little later. I wasn't always on the front line like Dhoruba was. But my experiences as far as tear gas and just like police just being real ruthless and locking us up, I was one of the 13 people to go to jail in Ferguson that night in front of the Ferguson Police Department, because we were all there for several nights at a time trying to get our point across to the police department who was responsible for Mike Brown's death. Dhoruba also went to jail, and me and my child spent more time in jail than Darren Wilson, and I think it's absolutely ridiculous. And this is day 74 now, and I'm not sure if everybody's paying attention to what's going on the news, but every day they release different bits and pieces of information of new things coming out about the case. They're saying that Mike Brown's blood was found on Officer Wilson's uniform, in the car, and on the gun. So basically they're preparing us for a non-indictment. And they thought it got crazy in Ferguson. The first few weeks, it's going to be crazy when we get back home. So Tribex and Freedom Fighters are just trying to prepare the people mentally to deal with this, because my biggest fear is that lives are going to be lost because of this. Because it's been going on for a while, and like he said, this is murder number 3 by the police in 2 months. And it's kind of hard for us to keep up and, you know, activate people for each and every one of those things, because we have so much focus on Mike Brown already. It's kind of like we're losing track, but we're not losing hope. So I encourage anyone who's willing and able to come to St. Louis and Ferguson within the next few days or weeks, please be
there to witness it yourself. Don't listen to CNN. Don't listen to Fox. Don't listen to any news channels. Dhoruba has a PowerPoint slide with his Facebook and Twitter information. He is more reliable of a source than any news station. And and you can follow the people that he follows that keeps you with the real, the raw, and the updated stuff. So that's all I have to say.
Just to talk about a little bit more of what's happened down there. When we occupied SLU, we had Q&As with the students. The first Q&A that we had, like 500-600 students showed up to the Q&A, and we're talking about like white supremacy, white privilege, and this is a predominantly white crowd. And I know if I was to just start talking about things right now, it might make some people feel uncomfortable, like it made them feel uncomfortable. And I just want to articulate that when having these conversations, it's not about making people feel guilty, you know what I'm saying? Because none of us are in control of the situations that we're born into. And this structure was already created before we were born. Having these discussions is about, once we acknowledge that privilege exists in these things, what do you do after that? And so that's one thing I want to articulate to you guys. And as white allies, a lot of these conversations should be started by you guys. If you guys know what's going on, don't be afraid to talk about these things. You know what I'm saying? Because hearing it come out of my mouth, it may, just because of the way that this conversation is, it comes off as like a negative thing. And people need to realize that you ignoring certain issues is almost as bad as you being on the other side. You know what I'm saying? It is as bad. You have to acknowledge these things and then act on them. And so if a lot of you guys are conscious and aware of these issues, I want to encourage you to fuck being an ally. You know what I mean? Like, do this shit. You know what I mean? Like, go out there and put your you're going to lose friends. You're going to lose friends, man. And that's the reality of this shit. You're going to lose friends in this process. And that's cool. You know what I'm saying? They want your friends in the beginning if they want to not hang out with you because you want to talk about these issues that have been going on for forever. Another point I want to make for the older generation in here, don't be scared of the youth, man. Don't be scared of the youth. Don't stop the youth. This may come off wrong, man, but I'm gonna say it. A lot of y'all, you had a chance, you know what I'm saying, to be on the forefront and to be leaders in whatever movement was going on when you were in your prime. But it's a new time now, and there's a lot of energy within the youth, and I know a lot of you guys bring wisdom, and I encourage you to bring that wisdom, but do not try to lead anything. You know what I'm saying? Like, it doesn't work that way. I know specifically in St. Louis, a lot of the youth are chasing off the people who want to approach things that way. And it's just a bad situation. So I want to encourage the youth, the older generation, to really try to get to know the youth, understand where they're coming from, understand that a lot of you guys were born in a situation that was bad and then got a little easier as you got older, and a lot of us were born in a situation that was easier when we were born, and now as time's going on, it's getting really fucked up, and we're seeing and we're acknowledging that. So understand the times, and really use the resources that you have to help the youth and guide the youth, and not try to lead the movement. Because I know in St. Louis, the clergy especially, a lot of them are older and they want to come out there like, this is the way to go, you know what I mean? Load your signs and march until your feet get tired, and that's not the way to go, you know what I'm saying? We're done marching. It's about real change, you know what I'm saying? And we're not going to get that change from marching around the issue all the time. Eventually, you got to stand there and hold your ground, and the elders got to be there with us, you know what I'm saying? Like, my father used to always say, like, if an adult comes up to you and puts his hands on you, you come tell me and I'm going to go to jail. You know what I'm saying? And that applies to this. They're messing with your kids right now. You know what I'm saying? So just because it's the police now, don't change that that mindset. These people are messing with your kids and things need to be addressed. So approach them as if they were anybody else on the street fucking with your kids. You're going to come at them a certain way. You need to do that with the police as well. And there's so much on my brain I could talk about.
Let me just say something.
All right.
Seriously, you know, when I said that I wanted to get him out of here, I really didn't even want to get him out of here to speak to nobody or anything. I just wanted him to get some rest because I've been there twice with him, and he's sacrificed everything. Everything. His sleep, his rest. The first time, the first 5 days that I was there, we got to have lunch. We ate with a couple Black Panther dudes, and we had lunch at this business in St. Louis. And that was the only time that he ever, him or me, seen her. This is how much he had himself out on the line. And she's being supportive, because some people would not support that. You ain't coming home at night. You're gone. He actually was staying in a hotel with us for an hour or two, the little rest that we got. And he's getting called nonstop. This last time was ridiculous. He's sleeping maybe 1 hour. That was just the first 2 days. Once they took over school, he didn't get no sleep. He's giving up. He's got a baby coming on the way, man. He's out there putting that movement all the way first. The ultimate sacrifice. I don't know if I can do that. I don't know. You know, I like to talk a good one, but he's for real. He's putting it on the line. Some people around here know me from in this community. I do put a little bit out on the line. Man, I haven't felt so proud of nobody in a long time. I love this brother.
We can take some questions and shit until something comes in my brain. Please don't be shy with the questions. Ask what you want to know if anybody has any questions.
I have a question, I guess, because I just didn't understand it. What was the reason for burning the Quick Trip plates? Or, I mean, I know that's against the police, but I don't understand why the vengeance was toward the Quick Trip plates or the payback. So if you could explain that.
Okay. I don't think it was meant to be on like any particular business. It was just that a lot of these people that were on the ground at the time, there is no other avenue for them to be vocal about anything. So it's like, if I could stop one of your major business hubs from functioning, you're going to pay attention to what's going on down here. So I think that's the reason why Quick Trip burnt down. It was like a way of saying, hey, I'm trying to say something.
The anarchists,
yeah. They were the ones
again,
that started.
With the burning of the building, it's simple direct action in a capitalist system. The capitalist structure only understands capital laws.
Right.
And how we create capital laws.
Right.
Any other questions?
Yeah. Boom. So when you got that letter from SLU, because I've read it, it's like a mess of demands, and they're just like, all right, you get a community center and some more funding and some more scholarships and all this stuff. What's that feel like? What was the mood after that? Because I know y'all probably taking down some tents and stuff like that. What's the mood after that?
Honestly, at the time when it was going down, everybody was in agreement with it, except for me and one other guy. We actually were the last ones to put our tents up. We wanted to stay. We felt like they were bullshitting us, and there was going to be some way around it. And after talking to the mothers of the organization, they're like our advisors, they kind of solidified it in our brains that, hey, this has never happened before, ever in history. You know what I'm saying? And so I'm a little at ease with it now, but I'm still on the fence about it, for real. Like, I'm expecting him to screw us any day, and I'm ready to go back out to SLU if that's the case, but that's just me being honest. But as a collective tribe, X and the Freedom Fighters, everybody is pretty excited about what's going on, especially because the situation is so weird. The president is brand new to the school. He's only been there for 3 months, so he's trying to cover his ass everywhere. So it's actually not far-fetched to think that he would actually attempt to do all of those things. You know what I'm saying? So that's kind of where I am with it.
I'm kind of like dubious about the word support, so I don't, I agree with you where you just get involved, you know, mm-hmm. just get out there. But if people can't go physically, what can you go back over, like what specific things people can maybe send monetarily or physical?
I got it on my laptop, but there's no projector, but I can, if you got a pen or your phone, there's a few ways you could help us from a distance. Tribex actually has a donate page now, and that is Tribex, T-R-I-B-E-X dash, not underscore, dash STL.org. So www.tribex-stl.org. Or if you want to donate to the Freedom Fighters, currently we have all the donations coming to my PayPal because we're slacking. You can send that to my email at Jeffrey Hill, JefferyHilljr at gmail.com. And that's a way you can help from a distance besides just spreading the message, you know what I'm saying? Like, because people need to hear it here as well. And I went to a rally last night. I'm not sure what it was called. And there's some people here who are on fire. And then there's some people who are on the fence. So I would recommend the people who are on fire to just really encourage the people who are on the fence about what we're facing and how we can't be passive about our actions, you know what I'm saying?
This is just kind of a taking temperature and seeing where people's thoughts are. I want to make it a more thoughtful question than a yes-no question, but it's a yes-no question. There was a 40-minute talk recently given by IDF, an Israeli Defense Force soldier, about his time serving in the IDF and what he did and saw in Palestine and how he later, and how horrible it was and how it galvanized him against all of that and the Palestinian occupation, and that he later came to the U.S. and talked with Maryland police who let him know that they were training in Israel, and his message to Americans was, "You're next," which I know that Ferguson has heard directly from Palestine. And I wonder if they're, like, what the conversation is among people in Ferguson about that angle.
There's some people who are ready for, like, a revolution, but as a whole, I would say people are not ready to, like, get up in arms and fight against the powers, you know what I'm saying? Even with having 3 murders done by the police in 2 months, some people are still not ready for that, you know what I'm saying? But when this no indictment comes, I don't know what's gonna happen, man. I really don't, because there's a lot of people who are like, they've been ready. We've talked people out of, like, yo, put the gun down, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's already been going on for weeks now. So when this no indictment comes, I think a lot more people are gonna be ready for that, you know what I'm saying? But yeah, it's a shaky situation, man. I don't know. Yeah, it's fucked up, man. Eventually, though, it's going to come to that, I feel like, for everybody, not just for y'all here, the whole nation, man, because it's much bigger than what we can see right now. Any other? Come on, y'all.
I have a question.
Yes.
Has Al Sharpton
in
one of
the
sessions?
Oh,
God.
Oh, no.
Can you see me in there?
Okay, so Al Sharpton and them, they came down. They came and did their thing. You know how they do. Yeah. And they.
Well, what did they do? What exactly? I mean, like,
They came in and got right with the family. And because of their history, the family welcomed them. And they were smoking a lot of churches. They got paid,
yeah.
And then they dipped out,
yeah.
And that's them.
You haven't seen them anymore, right?
Nah, not. He doesn't even talk about it on TV now. He's talking about, like, ISIS and foreign policies now. You know what I'm saying? He just came and got he did his PR stunt and bounced out. When I was a part of the major organization, what's his name? Jesse Jackson. Yeah, oh, God. He is, oh, man, he was a little worse. He showed up to a rally that we had did, and keep in mind, these major names didn't talk to anybody on the ground, not once, not once. So he showed up to the rally, and because of his name, someone handed him a bullhorn. And this is right after, because keep in mind, like I said, the organization had used this church as a safe space. And some windows were broken out of there, some toilets were messed up. So they decided to have an offering to give to the church so that they could fix some things. And everybody was down for that, you know what I mean? We're passing the buckets around, they're like, hell yeah, because this space has been like it for us, you know what I'm saying? And then Jesse Jackson comes out of nowhere right after that. Do 10 people got $100 in here? How many people got $100 to give? And that was the beginning of Ferguson chasing out people like that. He was the first one where he almost got beat up that day. Yeah. And it was bad. Yes. Jesse Jackson almost got beat up. Yes. It's a great day in history. Hell yeah. Y'all know. Y'all see that shit. Like, what is he doing?
I say it all the time, and a lot of white people just looked at me like, dude, careful, just Jackson.
Hell no. Get him out of here, man. If he shows up here for anything, don't even let him speak. No. Don't even let him get off the plane.
Great speech on the type of people that Jesse Jackson is and the type of people I'm sure you are. They talked about House and Field.
For sure.
How they look at the establishment and...
They got a whole different outlook.
When the master's house is burning down, who tried to help and who prayed for a win?
They tried to help it out. They went, put that out, man. Nah, let that burn, man. And, he got a taste. They haven't been back since. That's probably why they started talking about other things. It's because they how they got treated in Ferguson. But you guys should, I encourage you to do the same, for real. Not just big leaders like that. There's leaders in your own community who have the same ideologies. And... don't let them come and get in a position of power in movements like this. Like, stop it in its tracks, please, please, please. Because you'll spend a whole lot of time just debating ideologies with these people, and it's like there's an issue right now that we can see we're dealing with, and you should attack that and don't let them come and try to change the narrative. Anything else?
No, I'm talking too much, but...
No, definitely not.
What's your view... because I know we talked last night about this. What's your view on the media? Do you have the same reaction like you do with Jesse Jackson? What do you do when they stick a camera in your face?
It depends on the situation.
Yeah.
If we're in the heat of a moment, we're on the ground, and police are trying to get in position and stuff like that, media, get out of here, man. Like, we chase them out. We don't too much care for the mainstream media or the local media, because they always portray us to be monsters. Like, they portrayed us to be looting and rioting. A riot. I don't even think there was a riot besides that first day. That was the only thing. That property was damaged and stuff like that. So to say that we were rioting for 2 weeks and all that, like, that's what they do. They know that it's going to bring people to their channel on TV, so they don't give a fuck about what's really going on the ground, as long as they can just get their little shots. So I would encourage people to, for the most part, chase them out. But when you guys get to some type of point to where you get some wins and stuff like that as a community, I feel like, yeah, that's a good opportunity to get in front of a camera. But anything other than that, fuck them. Like, for real. Like, get out of here, dude. Because social media is really, that's the real news at this point. Like, Twitter is where it's at. And you find out everything on there. So you got a lot of, specifically in St. Louis and Ferguson, live streamers are everywhere around there. So we bring them in our circles, and we're like, yo, you get in the front, do all this, and MSNBC and CNN, we chase them out.
I'm just gonna kind of comment on far as like the mainstream news and all that. He's had interviews before, like all mainstream media pretty much sucks. But anything where they have a camera in your face, I think it holds more weight than you talking and them jotting stuff down. Because his words have gotten twisted before with an interview like that. And then that's when he was kind of reluctant to say anything else because they were calling him a racist and a whole bunch of other stuff. So.
Yeah. Miss Mary.
Federal Department of Justice has failed communities as far as addressing police brutality. also seems like there's a, that's like a focal point in St. Louis and in Ferguson to try to get something out of the Department of Justice.
Mm-hmm.
So, can you speak to that? Do you have a stance of hoping to get something, get some relief or some remedy from them?
Definitely
not. Or is
your
stance more like combative? And then that feeds into a question about solidarity actions around the country in a non-indictment. What should our stance be, if any, toward the Department of Justice in our local communities?
It's hard because not everybody is going through a Mike Brown situation currently, but you guys have in the past, you know what I'm saying, over and over and over again. So I feel like everybody should have the same attitude, like, fuck them, man. And they're not going to do anything. It's been proven throughout history that these people, they don't care about changing things. The community as a whole, it seems like that's the what's going on in Ferguson, because, like I said, these mainstream organizations, that's what they're pushing for, and they got the arms to stretch out and to kind of control the narrative outside of St. Louis better than we can. So that's like the thing that they're pushing. But on the ground, like for real, the people that come out day in and day out, they're not about that at all. They are ready to tear shit up, man. Like, it's beyond that point. Like I said, we've literally had to talk people down out of doing some insane shit because they're pushed over the edge at this point. And we're trying to figure out how we can radicalize everybody or a larger number than what we are right now. But that's the question of all questions. How do we get everybody on that page? How do we get everybody to realize that, yo, this is serious. It's been going on forever. We're all being affected by this. And the only way to do this is to tear the structure down. No one knows what that looks like. That doesn't necessarily mean we have to burn everything down. It could be something else. I'm cool with burning everything down if you want to, but that might not necessarily be the angle that everybody's comfortable with. And I'm open to other suggestions if someone else has something else to add to that. But I just don't know how to bring that conversation about.
Oh, I have something to add to that.
Yeah.
This is, and I don't want to change the subject too much, but I don't know if you've ever seen Jeremy Rifkin's book, The Empathic Civilization. It is a really, this fucker is like over 600 pages, but it is so worth like sitting with how he thinks through the whole arc of human history to like, this is specifically how you change how resources are produced and allocated so that people cannot fuck with you.
Right.
And it's all in very neutral terms. You can hang out with anarcho-communist, political, radical, all kinds of communities and see that he's laying out a plan that would bring that kind of thing about, but in terms that don't threaten people.
Mm-hmm.
So I would just suggest that as one reference point. And again, I'm in the same place where you are, where I feel like there's some good like weather eyes on the horizon. We have music we can dance to, mm-hmm. but we're going to create something that nobody knows what it looks like till we build it.
For sure. I need that before we leave, that information again, because I just forgot.
I'll get with you.
Definitely.
I think just as a comment more than a question, but I think a lot of people, you know, they don't want to be radicalized. The whole idea is completely off-putting, which of course I don't agree with. But I'm thinking for those kinds of people that want to kind of think that things are more peaceful or going about it in a peaceful way, the concept of parallel systems I think is huge, because we can at the same time as we're starting revolution be creating the kinds of systems that we need to survive once that revolution is taking place. Like, how do we feed each other? We got community gardens, and really not at all downplay the importance of those peaceful kinds of community building things. I mean, that's what do we want? What do we want this thing to look like after revolution has taken place? You know, and make that happen now. You know, that's all.
I was gonna say, to add to that, like, so burn down a grocery store, but before you do that, take the food and spread it around.
That was that shit.
Yeah.
How do we do that without the police calling out and taking us down?
Warfare?
No.
You should.
I'm not gonna get up on my book game, really. I've just been running off of like emotions, man, for the past 2 months. Not a lot of studying like I should be. You gotta put a hand back there?
Yeah, I was actually playing at Repression.
I think he's swatting flies.
I want to tell y'all some real shit.
Real
sometimes
shit.
Sometimes I kind of talk in general, but I'm going to tell you some real shit. When I said that he sacrificed everything, the man is homeless now. He ain't told y'all that. This is just some real shit. His dogs is even in the dog pound. He got a pit bull named Blue and Lady.
Blue
and Lady. Right now, they're in the pound.
Doggy jail.
Yeah, they're homeless right now. Because they were in the county. Some shit about you can't have a pit bull in the county. I'm talking about he's giving it all up. And he ain't here telling you that because this is who he is. He's sacrificing his whole self in there. And so I'm just telling you, man. Before you leave here, and my name ain't Jesse Jackson. Don't run me out of here. My name ain't Jesse Jackson, man. But give his brother some love, man. For real, man. He really could use it. He ain't gonna sit there and tell you that. He's out there last night with the homeless people and going through it with somebody about homeless. And he homeless himself. And they thinking that he might not have good intentions. So I'm just giving you some real shit about this brother, man. He's sacrificing himself, and I have to again applaud his old lady and the baby up in there, because they're not getting their, what they're supposed to get out of this. You know, they're not getting any of his time. The movement is getting all of his time, and she's being the supportive one. I tip my hat to her, but that's the real shit, man. Miss out on that Jeeva Theater this weekend. Please, don't go this weekend, man. Support my brother, man. Support him, man. Please.
I want to mention one other thing. Me and her have spent more time in jail than Darren Wilson through all this shit.
Yeah.
And that's a fucking shame, man. My baby hasn't even been born yet. He's been in jail, boy.
You get in the system early, you know.
Gotta start early, you're right. Yeah, any more questions? Not one more. 10 more, for real. I mean, I'm chilling with y'all, man.
I got one.
Pick. Oh, okay.
Community center. I saw it. It's in writing. It's all over Facebook. It's all over Facebook. All over Twitter. From Occupy St. Louis University Community Center. Is that where we're gonna have education of the children happening?
Yes.
Definitely.
Yes. Because when I'm thinking about back to the Black Panther Party, who started the breakfast program, which fed me all through elementary school, because my parents didn't have the money, so like. Like, what's on the horizon for that kind of thing?
That's definitely on the program. We want to feed kids before and after school. I'm a musician. One of the services that I want to add is, like, free services all around music. So if somebody wanted to come in and get an album made, whether it's rap, rock, because we got the capabilities to record up to, like, an 8-piece band. So we want to be able to offer all those services for free. And, like, I can't tell Quan to get off the block and stop hustling if I can't create some other alternative for him to be able to create fun. So I think me personally, you know, there's a lot of other people who are involved in this who have other skills that are going to be applied, like the community garden, which has already been started. It's been in effect in St. Louis for some years now, and the person that's in charge of that is 100% behind what we're doing, and they want to start another garden on the property that we'll have. So these are different things that we want to begin once we get the building. But even that, you know what I'm saying, that's gonna take some time to really wake and just activate a lot of people in the community. So if there's other things that people have to offer, please send those in. Like, we need all the help we can get. And also try to apply those things here before a Mike Brown situation happens. I know in a conversation that I had earlier with some people, they were like, yo, We're specifically talking about you guys' new first black lady mayor. And yeah, they're like, how do we dismantle her without looking like a racist? And one way you can do that is by giving your time to the black community now. Like, show people that you're really down for them. You know what I'm saying? Like, you don't gotta start off the discussion like, yo, we gotta get her the fuck up out of here. Like,
it didn't help that the other guy's last name was white.
Oh, no. So many layers to this shit.
It's like,
it's like I would just start by servicing the community in every way possible that you can right now. Like, really get down with the homies out there and, like, don't just show up when it's time for some shit to go off. Like, be there now, implant yourself in that community, and then you can start to educate people on different things. But right now, people are failing on a fundamental level, so we need to help them out there and gain trust in that way in the community, and then we can start to maybe implement our ideologies if they see fit. So that's another thing to consider. They might not agree with your ideologies, and that's okay, but still try to service the community and help them out, because that'll go a long way in the long run. Come on, y'all. This
and he had a life before Mike Brown.
Yes.
So I want to know, when is that video that you made, you and Six made, before Mike Brown, when you gonna make that accessible? I seen it.
That comes out in the morning. Yeah. It comes out tomorrow morning. Follow me on Twitter and Facebook and check out my music video and shit. Yeah, no, but we made this song called Black and White.
Black Eagle White.
Black Eagle White. Before Mike Brown passed, like 3 months before he passed. And it was just
because
crazy.
We had a shitty landlord.
Yeah, we had a slumlord. And we decided to make a song about him. It applies to so many different things. You actually wouldn't even be able to tell that it was about a landlord. And it's extremely well shot. The dude that did it for us ended up moving to New York a week after we recorded it. He's been working on it all these months, and he finally got it finished, so we're gonna drop that tomorrow. But once that drops, put it on your Twitter, share it, help us out. But yeah, I want some questions from this back wall over here, man. Some interesting people over here. Yeah, I can definitely do that.
Have you guys contacted any other groups like the American Indian Movement or any of those groups that have
no.
been fighting the minority equality rights, especially like with all the problems on the reservation, Pine Bear Reservation in South, I believe it's right there in South Dakota, or Southern North Dakota. But like the American Indian Movement, they're like the guys who really, John Trudell, Russell Means before he passed, these were all guys who really started that occupying, like when they occupied Alcatraz for like, I want to say a week. There was Wounded Knee, they took over for 71 days. They were the first people to really brandish arms again and say, we're not leaving, and we don't want to shoot, but we're not leaving, and if you come in, well, then
we might have to shoot.
They were used to, were really close with the Black Panther Party way back in the old days there, and I know they're still functioning, and I'm sure they're currently fighting. There's like a couple land grabs in Canada they're fighting against right now. Like, I don't know if you know about like the poverty rates and like the reservation.
Yeah,
like,
they're horrible.
Reservations. Like, I grew up in Ghost Town right around here, Jay and Glide area. And let me tell you, the first time I set foot on a reservation, I still didn't believe people lived there. Mm-hmm. And it's like, you know, I thought the neighborhood I came from was poor, but I'm sure those organizations would. And someone like you doesn't really necessarily know, have the experience organizing a mass occupation the way they have in the past, but
if you can bridge that gap, please.
I'd be more than glad. We'll get together.
Definitely. Jump today, around. I'm
you're saying you're hanging out, right?
I'm building with y'all after this.
So.
Drink a beer, have a couple cigarettes. Have a good time. We need some more questions, though. I'm going to get this lady right here, and then you back there, sir.
Bringing down the dictator, how they did that, how they kept it going for 2 years across the whole country.
Yeah.
And so when I think about Ferguson and all the great businesses you guys have been doing, like in my mind, I'm visual,
brutality there, you know, as you said, it's here, it's everywhere, it's all over the place. And so how do we, and I guess that's a question for all of us to think about, like, use this momentum to create this national effort.
We need to become friends. We gotta become friends and just start organizing. I don't know any other way but just making these relationships really mean something besides me just standing in front of you and saying words, like, really call me next week, like, yo, what's going on? What can I do? I got X amount of number of people who are ready to do whatever, you know what I'm saying? Like, how can we make this connection even though we're not in the same place? And I think that's a good place to start, just having, like, these solidarity actions all over the place once we've made these connections and just building on that, because you guys got some things that you could offer us and we got some things that we could offer you, and we just need to continue to build on that and really do it, you know what I'm saying? Like, I don't think anybody's actually done it. It's just been, what do? You know what I mean? And then that's just where it ends. Like, it's about, give me your number when I leave. I'm gonna give you my number. I'm gonna get to know you, and let's just exchange resources and pick each other's brain apart till we come to some type of conclusion, man. Because at this point, I don't want to let this flame die out. And I know that they're trying to kill it. You know what I'm saying? They're doing everything in their will to kill it. So we have to do everything in our will to not let it die. When you get off of work, I'm going to call Dhoruba today or something, or whoever you know, and let's get together and build something. You guys got the homeless movement going on right now, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm sure some way we could blend those together and make something happen and whatever, you know what I mean? Like, I don't know. Like you said, that's a conversation for all of us, but we need to first get to know one another and become friends. In the back.
So police brutality, you know, is definitely happening in Rochester, it's happening all over the place. You know, these events, they, you know, they're constantly all over the country. But at the same time, we're not seeing the same kind of uprising, we're not seeing the same kind of mobilization, you know, in Rochester, you know, and other places where this is taking place, Albany, you know, all over New York, whatever. So I just wanted to ask what your thoughts are on what about the situation in Ferguson that you think led to this, you know, to this uprising, to this massive movement that is building right now?
To be honest, I think it just happened, man. I don't think there was some special formula to this. I think that the way that he was killed and the actions that followed after that, the city of Ferguson just couldn't ignore it anymore. They've already been dealing with issues for forever, you know what I'm saying? And that was just like the breaking point for everybody there. And just leaving a body out for 4 hours uncovered, man, like that's crazy, you know what I'm saying? That's unheard of. You said what?
That's just routine procedure, right?
Yeah, I got you. Yeah. Routine, just leave it out there. It was almost like they were trying to...
Even if you weren't trained, I mean, you would just leave it there.
You wouldn't do anything. Like, the way that they maneuvered around that situation, just, there was no way that people were going to ignore that. You know what I'm saying? And they're not going to fuck up like that probably here. You know what I'm saying? But
I don't know.
They might. I don't know. The people...
Shit.
Police are fucked up everywhere, but.
They beat the shit out of dude in a wheelchair.
Yeah, I heard that.
Yeah. Oh, three people that have been shot by them.
I'm gonna try to play this song while you guys. It's not connected.
And when you see the video tomorrow, remember their face because they don't look the same. They both had their dreads. It's at the volume. Oh.
Is there any other questions? Are we listening to this track?
You guys see?
I don't gotta see it. You'll see it tomorrow. You'll see. It's not that important. It's really not. It's really not.
No, I was just asking why you cut your locks.
I cut my locks because I was doing free forms and I stood out. like crazy, man. Like people, they knew who I was from a mile away, including the police. Yeah. And so I just wanted to blend in a little better and makes me look a little bit more militant. So I like that. And another thing, I feel like my locks is like, I feel like that's something that I should grow when I'm in a place in my life to really experience life, you know what I'm saying? And you'll be able to see that in my locks. So I just decided to cut it off because I'm not in that place yet. And it's time for me to get real grimy right now. So cut it off for that. Yeah, more questions. No, I'm not Rastafarian. I do like weed. No. I like weed. Mm. Definitely. I definitely gotta see you after this. But anything else? Come on, y'all. We gotta, come on. Anything. Oh, Ted, hell yeah.
So you're gonna be a father. And yes. I'm gonna be a father soon. And thank you. I wasn't doing it for that, I swear.
Our lives are over, Tim. They're completely over.
That's my question. You know, like, when you have the baby, like, what happens then? Is that even on your radar now? Because on my radar right now is ending mass incarceration. Not thinking about a baby, but I probably start thinking about that, you know?
Like, I'm going to put him in army fatigue, and he's coming out there with me. Pretty much. I'm serious. I don't know what else to do.
Yeah, right.
I can't be a father right now. No, I plan on trying to add some balance to my life eventually. But right now, while I'm in a position to like give it all, I figure I should do that. Because who knows what can happen in these couple of months. But eventually, I am going to have to turn it down a notch. But yeah. Hopefully, we got that national platform before then so that I'm able to do that. And that'll be dope. But,
thank you.
Like I said, our lives are over, man. So we should actually put our heads together. Maybe you can babysit one weekend, babysit another.
We'd love to come to, you know, Ferguson.
For sure. Yeah. Anything else? Yes.
Fuck
the police.
What pumps me up and what pumps me up, I don't think it's like a specific soundtrack. I think it's just the chants and the energy of the people. Like, I found myself chanting when I'm not around them, just like randomly in the store, like, fuck the police and no justice, no peace. And I really think that fuels me, because like Ricardo said, it's not easy being supportive in the beginning. I was like, oh, you're crazy, you're just out there day and you don't give yourself a break. But I had to learn to let him blossom into the person he is, because he's changed drastically in 74 days, like you guys wouldn't believe it. And I really appreciate that growth, because he's helping me become a better person, believe it or not. And the balance is just, it all comes from support. And I think if we take the time to love each other more, the police and other people will have no choice but to love us. But right now, they don't see that from us, and we don't see that from each other as a people. So that's something we got to get back to, just love and unity and just peace and all that good stuff.
Which hasn't happened in America yet, guys. I want to make that be known. That hasn't existed in this country yet, so we all got to figure that out, what that looks like. It's happened for specific groups of people, but not everybody together just loving on each other, so boom. Oh.
Start with them at Trayvon Martin.
I saw them at Trayvon Martin the Trayvon Martin rally after the verdict first. And those same group of faces turned that whole thing up. And at that time, I wasn't involved in anything. I'm like, hell yeah, let's destroy some shit, you know what I'm saying? And when I saw them at the Mike Brown rally, I was like, what's going on, you know what I mean? Like, this is weird. And I felt like they were changing the narrative from what it was supposed to be. And I actually, me and my friends, we were like kind of chasing them off for like 2 weeks straight, you know what I'm saying? Like every time we see them, we would chase them off. But now I've met with those guys, had a few conversations with them since then. I understand where they're coming from and I like them a lot. You know what I mean? We're starting to plan things together, not burning things down per se, but we're strategizing on what we can do to implement change. And I want to encourage you guys to embrace them when you see them in your community, like for real, embrace them. Because a lot of them are like, a lot of them mentally are, they are ahead of us. They are light years ahead of us. They're like, fuck it. I don't care if Mike Brown fought back. I don't, he's dead and that's all that matters. You know what I mean? And that's how we all should be. But we're like, well, did he really grab the gun? Was the weed that strong? You know what I mean? Like, they're way beyond that. Oh, man. They're blaming everything on weed right now. And
I know. I smoked one marijuana. Oh.
No, not Darren. Mike Brown. Yeah, he was on weed for sure. It's the only time you hit the clip.
He steal drugs in St. Louis and got caught on his job. High on the drugs he confiscated from someone in St. Louis. Yeah.
This is real.
At least pay for it.
That's what I'm saying. You could have bought that shit. You didn't have to steal it from me, so I can't make no money. But the anarchists, I really appreciate them. And they're like family to me now. And I encourage y'all to do the same because they've always been around.
Yep.
And they've always been looked at in a certain light. And we've tried every other alternative except for theirs, so maybe it's time to kind of shift that way.
Well, just in article, 9 ways direct action has gotten more change than peaceful protest, oddly enough. I read that at like 6 a.m. this morning, oddly.
Because it's them, it's you like saying enough is enough, bro.
Stone, yeah. Go on their website, you'll find it, I promise.
I'm definitely going to check out that article. And the people that believe in legislation, I want to articulate this a little bit more. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. And sometimes it works temporarily and it pacifies us, but it's not systemic change. And that's what we need. Which is going to require us to establish something new. And sometimes you have to destroy the thing that's standing in order to do that. And that looks a little different. Now, I'm not just saying everybody's going to smash some shit. That's not what I'm saying. Let's get that right. That's not what I'm saying. But wait a minute. What? Wait a minute. But for real, like, I think some of the more established organizations should start to incorporate anarchists in their circles because they have a lot to add, and you might have a lot to add to them that they don't know. So just bring everything tighter, you know what I'm saying? Everything that exists right now, even though you guys may have different ideologies, there's things that we can agree on right now, and I feel like you guys should get together and really harness those things out. And if you guys want to vote, and if they want to tear something up, that's cool. You know what I mean? They both can work hand in hand. You know what I'm saying? That's not impossible. And I commend them for fighting this long against us. You know what I'm saying? Because all these years they've still been here with the same agenda. And they've kind of conformed me a little. You know what I mean? And their methods work. You guys wouldn't know about any of this shit if the Quick Trip wouldn't have burned down. You know what I'm saying? The news wouldn't be there. Mike Brown would just be another boy dead. Even with those events that followed his death, you know what I'm saying? It would be just something scraped under the rug if it wasn't for Quick Trip burning down. And I just think we need to really evaluate all of our tactics and all of our resources, them being one.
Well, I'm sorry,
another group popped in my mind.
For sure.
Like, there's like, I don't know if you follow, like, in like Rio de Janeiro and like Sao Paulo, Brazil, like the anarchist black bloc groups are a very heavy presence. They lead what we, what most of the news here calls riots, is usually planned direct action.
Like pumpkin throwing.
No.
Like, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding.
Full scale.
No justice, no police.
No police.
Like the chant, the main chant in Brazil is police retreat combative youth that's in the street. And that's usually as everyone's putting on masks, goggles, everything to protect from that. Homemade body.
I don't live without it now, man. I don't live without it. Any other questions? Come on, y'all. I know it's gotta be a few more. Yes, sir.
I'm not the most eloquent person, so I'll say that first. To what extent do you grapple with the possibility that we will not be able to escalate as quickly or as effectively as the state can repress us? It's something that nags me constantly when I think about this stuff, you know? There's a big fucking machine out there.
It's the reality. It's fucked up, man. It's like, but I try to think that they can't function without us, so that's one thing to think about. Yusef.
I almost have a question, a statement. When we talk about organized violence, it has to be organized in a greater context of people. The power of the people is greater than the machines. However, if we're forcing ideas on the people, how better are we are against those we're fighting against?
Right.
The ideas have to come out of the people.
Right.
And the only way to come out of the people by being connected with the people.
Yep.
And serving the people. Again, when we can't lead the people without empowering the people.
Right.
So there's many layers to this. But understanding, again, when you're talking about the black struggle, it was attacked by COINTELPRO. Yeah. So when you look at Ferguson, it had no leadership development because of our organization being attacked. So they've been able to break free mentally. So when you look at white communities and when you guys organize, you haven't suffered the way we suffered.
Right.
You know, his name wasn't Dhoruba. My name wasn't Yusef. We change our names in the process of reclaiming who we are.
Yeah.
In the process of re-identifying ourselves. So again, if we need to understand the transformation of who we are. You know, the greatest weapon of revolution is love.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, so but if you're not transforming your lives and you're just out here fighting, mm-hmm. what are you fighting for?
Right.
We have to be clear on what the objectives are, but more importantly, that serving the people is the greatest weapon of who we are through our love for the people.
For sure.
I definitely agree with that.
I'd just like to take this moment. Che Guevara, at the risk of the quote of Che Guevara, at the risk of sounding foolish, one cannot call themselves a revolutionary without first being born out of love. A revolution cannot be born out of anything other than a love for the people.
For sure.
And,
most dead. Any other questions?
Nah. What do you think that you've seen has been the most effective way to change the mind of those on the fence?
Radicalizing them by putting them on the front lines. A lot of them want to help in some way, shape, or form, and it's like, all right, there's this jail fund, there's people willing to get us out of jail. You like walking on the sidewalk, right? Let's go walk on the sidewalk and see what happens. Walk on the sidewalk, have the police bump you over your head, and it'll radicalize you. Not necessarily in that way, but like a lot of the SLU kids, they had never participated in any civil disobedience and stuff like that. So a lot of them didn't quite understand where we were coming from, and then we marched out and blocked Grand off.
So putting them like in that situation as opposed to them just seeing it.
Exactly. Put them in the situation. Like that was the Natasha back there. She was she took part in one of the actions where, like I said, the entire weekend people hadn't seen anything. And we didn't want them to go home with this thought that Ferguson is this huge party celebration and people are just fucking around And if they get tear gassed, it was probably because they were doing stupid shit. Like, no, we had to show them what was going on. Like, we just let them know, hey, it's the civil disobedience. There's a chance you might get arrested. Come with us. And people came with us, and all those people that were on the fence were no longer on the fence. And they told their friends, and they came out the next night in numbers that we didn't even imagine. So it's, I feel like you just got to make your reality their reality in whatever way you can do that in. Like, just bring it to their face, just like it's in my face and in your face every single day. We can't get it off of our brains. It's in everything that we do, you know what I'm saying? Like, bring that to them. Don't let them avoid that by saying they got to go to work and do all these other things. All right, we'll make time for it. When do you get off? Okay, let's go do this. Let me take you somewhere, you know what I'm saying? Like, really investing in them and getting them out there. And don't let them just observe from a distance. Like, literally bring it to their house.
Speaking of bringing it to their house, I saw on YouTube the people who did the direct action at the St. Louis Symphony.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And that I was wondering what you thought about that. Like, that was an example in a survey where they kept doing direct actions, spontaneous creative direct actions, like, everywhere.
Yep.
And in places where people wouldn't expect it, like at the symphony.
Exactly.
So I was just wondering what you guys thought about that.
That was amazing.
That was so.
There were so many rich people there who had to avoid this shit forever. And it was like, they thought that they were going to be able to sip on their whatever the fuck and listen to this. And then all of a sudden people are like, what side are you on? It's like, what the fuck is that? You know what I mean? So like, it made them uncomfortable. And some of them, it might have pushed them even more to the other side. Which is cool, you know what I'm saying? You're going to have that. But just bringing it, like you said, at all different, there's many different places. And to, like, keep doing that, we can't let that stop. You know what I'm saying? We can't do that for one weekend and then all of a sudden they never see it again. Like, we have to be consistent with that to let them know, hey, this is an issue that I can't run away from. And your ignorance to it is causing Mike Brown situations, you know what I'm saying? And causing many other things to happen. So I would just, I really encourage those types of things. And if people are willing to put in the footwork to organize things like that, do it. Like, do it. I don't care if it's 10 people. Like, just constantly put it in their faces and make them know that at least there's a small group of people out here who are thinking about this constantly. And you're not going to be able to rest while they're alive. So just keep doing that. And we're going to keep doing it. There's already different plans going on for the no indictment and stuff like that. So the things are going to be consistent in Ferguson, I would say, at least for the next couple of months. But we gotta get this out everywhere and have people doing things all over the place. Like, you guys could do the same thing, you know what I'm saying? And it would have the same effect, even though Mike Brown hasn't been here. But you guys have your own issues. Like somebody said earlier, someone got beat up by the police in a wheelchair. Like, that shit's not right. On any day, you know what I'm saying? No situation is that shit cool. And you guys should be vocal about that. Like, yo, that's not right. You know what I mean? Like, you don't have to kill him for us to get angry and to be vocal about it. Like, speak up on every little thing that happens. Every single thing that happens. Like, make it big. Because a lot of the white allies have the resources, and because they have the resources, some of them feel like they should dictate what their help looks like, and I don't think that should exist, you know what I'm saying? Like,
how do you handle that? What do you guys do to make sure
we just try to control the narrative. We try to be intimidating. That helps. You know what I mean? You're not gonna, if we've been rallying and leading these protests for several days in a row, I don't think that you're gonna be able to come down there and put in your two cents without having a conversation with somebody out there. So just making sure that the people stay in control And if people want to help, make sure they come and say, hey, how can I help? Instead of, yo, I think this will work better. I think this is what you should do. You know what I'm saying? Like, nip that shit in the bud as soon as it starts. As soon as you see that start to manifest, get rid of it. You know what I mean? And it may come off as rude, but people got to understand, man, that as white allies, I'm sorry, you can't dictate what the help looks like. You know what I'm saying? Like, you just got to be willing to help in whatever way that is. And if it goes against your principles or something like that, then don't be a part of that. But if it's just you don't think that it'll be effective, you got to get that out of your brain, because the people are going to know what's best for the things that they're dealing with. So that's how we try to avoid it, by just whenever we see it, we stop it. And it has happened. It happened in the very beginning a whole lot. And some people were changed, and some people maneuver a little differently now, and the other, they just don't come out anymore. And that's cool. Hopefully they'll turn around eventually, but you gotta stop that in its tracks. And it's not like I hate to kind of make it strictly a black and white thing, but this situation specifically is, you know what I'm saying? And we can't, there's no way around that, you know what I mean? So as a privileged person, a person who has the resources, you can't dictate how people use those. If you're gonna help, then you're gonna help. You're just gonna give them. And if they try to maneuver any other way, you know that they're not in the same place as you. And you gotta deaden that, because that's dangerous for the movement. To me personally, I feel like it'll ruin things, man. So we just try to stop it when we see it happening, which is kind of confrontational, but it's got to be that way. Like, this is new for everybody, you know what I'm saying? Like, this is, it's never happened before, so don't be afraid to try different things. Did you have any other questions since you came in late? For sure. If that's it, then thanks for having me, y'all. I appreciate it.
Luther's the only king that I mean, Luther's the only king that y'all show. Sorry, white people, but we are not equal. I'm sorry, white people, but we are not equal. I'm sorry, white people, but we are not equal. Thought the movie was over, but check it, it's the sequel. Sorry, white people, but we are not equal. I'm sorry, white people, but we are not equal. I'm sorry, white people, but we are not equal. Thought the movie was over, but check it, it's the sequel. Sorry, white people, but we are not equal. I'm sorry, white people, but we are not equal. I'm sorry, white people, but we are not equal.